We're not actors or TV personalities. We're just a couple of guys who want to show you how to restore your car. Sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we consult the pros. It's never a problem. It's always a project.
This week on Autorestomod, Vinny sleeps with classic instruments, Jeff gets hot, sticky, and shiny while finishing up the door panel refurb. Shiny.
Order a bunch of parts to get ready for the car show this weekend?
And I got a hot deal, too.
You think? Think again.
Oh, man.
Tired of back orders? You need NPD. With four strategically located superstores, orders are shipped direct to your door within 1 to 3 business days. National Parts Depot has quality restoration parts for Ford truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll free.
All right, we're back this week with getting that door panel finished up on the car. And Vinny's been hard at work getting the interior done and getting the engine bay all finished up with the wiring. Hard at work. I got an idea. Vinny!
man.
Look, man, get back to work. Quit napping with the blankets. I know they put you to sleep like they do me. But why are you cradling the instrument?
I don't know. The allergy medicine got me.
Wow. Get to work, man. I'm going to get working on the door panel.
All right.
All right, this week's tool segment, we're going to kind of go over what we're working with in the second half of the episode. For the first part of the episode, what you're going to be seeing is the tools from last week. So go out and check out last week's episode for the tools that we used to do the final work on the white panel board. Now, this week we're going to be using contact cement, and I recommend getting a good contact cement like the Weldwood that we've got right here. Another adhesive that we're going to be using is the 3M08001 weather strip adhesive, and this is to put the vinyl over onto the white panel board. We'll also be using a heat gun. Now, you're going to need one of these for doing a lot of the vinyl work post-application of the vinyl to the whiteboard. I recommend a good one. You're also going to be using the sponge rollers to basically apply the glue to the white panel board, and you use a brush to apply the glue to the vinyl itself. And you'll also need some gray 3M Scotch-Brite pads. Now these pads will be used to clean the vinyl up, where you're going to be using the weather strip adhesive that we've got right here on the table to put the vinyl over on the back of the whiteboard. So let's get busy. Okay, so we did a couple of things on here that we wanted to point out to you guys because we made a dramatic error with this, and that is our front park lights. Now, everything that I have ever worked on that is a Ford ground is black, except on 65 and 66 park lights. It turns out that on the park light end of the harness, brown is actually your ground lead, and black, incredibly, is your park light. The blues are, in fact, your turn signals. Now, the problem with that is this. With your harness that you get from the guys at American Autowire, they're using a brown wire for the park lights. So when I first started wiring this thing up, I went down and I bought some shrink wrap that's blue to tie in with the original stuff because we just couldn't bring ourselves to cut these. So the brown I tied into the brown wire, which is in back the ground. And obviously none of the park lights work, so we had to go back in and change all that. So be advised that when you're setting this up, that your brown needs to go to the black wire on your original lights, and your blue needs to go to the blue wire on your marker lights. So that's how that needs to wire up. And the brown coming off of here is in fact your ground.
So we have an actual oil pressure gauge in this car, so you're going to need to replace the oil sending unit, and this one's angled, so it makes for a much easier connection. Now, a couple other things that you see under the hood is we've got wires here for an electric fan and also for fog lights. Now, we're not ready for those just yet, so we've put female connectors on those so they won't ground out. We're also going to put little rubber boots over those that you typically see, like in the parts store, you get them for vacuum hoses. Now, over here, we've got one other connection for an electric choke. We do have plans to use that. Now, there were a couple other wires that we don't have plans for just yet. Those are still present. They're just wrapped back into the harness, and we've taped them up so they're out of sight.
All right, well, I'm gonna go ahead and get busy on those door panels. Vince is gonna continue on with our wiring harness on the car. From here on out, it's up to you.
Let's do it.
All right, now I've just done a final test right before this. I'm gonna put the skin that we're gonna be using aside so as to not damage it. And now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna cut my hole for the window crank here. Now you'll notice I've gone in and actually redone all of the holes for the clips that hold the panel too. There's a reason for that is that I wasn't real crazy about these, and on the original panel, they were really badly busted out. So I kind of just did a guesstimate measurement going off the bottom edge, and that's gonna be different for every different car, so that's something to keep in mind of. The other thing I'm gonna tell you is this: if you're using the particle board screws like we're using on ours, you'll wanna do something like what I've done here, where I've put some tape around the particle board screw. If you don't, you could end up doing what I've done to my hand, which is basically tried to cut it into shreds, cleaning all the residue from working the particle board off of the particle board itself. So I'm gonna deploy my sexy safety glasses and grab my hole saw and get ready to cut the hole for the window crank here. Okay, well, the next thing I'm gonna do that I'm gonna show you here is actually working one of the holes for the door clips. You'll take a drill bit. I want to put this on the very end here, and this is basically the same size as the hole needs to be. And no matter how much you try not to break the backside of this paneling, you're going to probably do it because of the nature of how it's constructed. Now I'm going to use this tool. Now, quite frankly, I am a little come see come saw about these type bits that are used for small routering work like this, because they seem to have, the best way I can describe it is their own mind about where they're gonna go. Now, we've already done it in a couple of areas. We've done it up here on the front part of the door panel, and I've had mixed success with this. What can happen is you can set up a vibration in the tip on these, and when you do, it will bounce all over the place and gore whatever happens to be in the way. Most of the time, fortunately, it's just whatever it is that you're working on. But just keep in mind that you do have a chance of actually wrecking your work using one of these. Now, because I don't want to disturb Vinny working on the 65, what I've done is the Lonely Man's Helper. Basically, it's a big full jug of lizard skin material that we're going to be using on the 69 wagon down the road. But for right now, it makes a handy dandy holder to keep the back of this from flopping around while I'm cutting my holes for the door opening right here. Now, I've gone from the 1 1/8 inch bit that we used for the door crank setup, and I've gone to a 1 inch bit. I'm going to try to set this up where it's just a little inside those black lines. Okay. Those are cut. Now I'm going to grab my little saw and go in and actually hand cut the larger opening here. All right, I'm using a little hand saw here. Basically, this is just for doing this kind of tight work on the panels. Who am I kidding? I'm going to do this with a jigsaw. Power tools! Well, that's why power tools are better, because that took, I don't know, less than half the time it would take to do that with the handsaw I started out using. Okay, now you've noticed that we've got our panel laid out on top of this. And what we're gonna do at this point is we're gonna muck around with position on this till it's right up against this top edge. And hopefully we can use that as our stabilizing point for running the rest of the panel. I'm just going to put my clamps right here on the very edge. Now, what I'm going to end up doing here is taking this outside here in a second and gluing this in position. So, now what we got to do is go outside and start working with a glue, because the last thing you want to do is start using items like our contact cement inside a non-ventilated area, because it will mess you up. All right, now we're going to go in, show you how to glue the panels down and how to dye them. The one problem you may run into whenever you're doing these kind of panels is how old this vinyl actually is. And in order to set this up and to make it work, you're going to need to flip this back over. You'll notice that I've got clamps along the top edge. This is the edge that goes up underneath the chrome reveal molding on the 69 Fairlane. A lot of the cars use that. If it doesn't have this, your job becomes exponentially harder because you're going to have to try to clamp down on this upper edge, and you may leave marks in your vinyl if you leave those clamps there too long. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to flip this over, trying not to kink that vinyl too much at the top. We're only going to glue to about right here on the panel. We're not going to glue all the way up, and then we're going to have to take and somehow get our glue with a brush on the vinyl portion of this up here as well. Your operating temperature needs to be about 75 degrees for this contact cement to work. You'd like to have under 50% relative humidity for fast work times, but around here, with as wet and nasty as it has been outside lately, that's just not going to happen. We're going to have a higher relative humidity, and therefore it's going to take this stuff a lot longer to work. You'll need to stir it up till you get a good consistency so that it looks kind of like cake batter. Now, there's a couple of different things that you can use to do this. You can use rollers or brushes. I'm going to use a combination of that, and the reason for that is this. I don't want to get any of the glue on the outside edges. I'm going to use actually weather strip adhesive to pull those over and set them on the back. These little foam rollers, basically they're just smooth surface foam rollers. These will work just fine for doing what we're doing here. What you want to do is just roll this stuff out in a consistent direction. And according to the instructions for this, the contact cement needs to be glossy whenever you're through with it. In other words, whenever it's ready to work, it needs to be glossy. Now, if it's dull, and this looks like it is a little dull, we'll need to go back in and put a little more cement on it. And this will need to sit about 10 to 20 minutes in our kind of weather conditions that we're having right now, which is really humid. Okay, now the tough one. We're going to have to go in and flip this around so that we can actually dress this top edge up here. And I'm going to go a little further with this than I went with the base so that when we lift this other edge up, it'll be easier for me to get the adhesive on. Now I'm going to use brushes on the top. And the reason I'm using brushes is it's just going to be easier to manage than the roller was. Basically, those rollers are useless now. We're going to throw it away when we're done with them. All right. We're going to take and use our brush and get some contact cement on it and just start spreading it on here. Now, you'll note, I don't know if you can really see this or not, but I'm actually not going past this foam that's on here if I can help it. I don't want to get any of this out where it can be adhesed to the other setup. Well, I'll go ahead and finish brushing this. Make sure your heaviest application, your best application, is on these strips where the old board was at. That's what's actually going to hold tight to the panel, more so than anything else. The rest of it is not as important. You want to get some adhesive on there, but you're not as worried about that as you are about the actual pieces of old particle board. All right. Now our glue needs to sit for about 20 minutes, so I'm going to set my timer for 20 minutes, and I am going to go in the house and cool off. Super hot out here. Okay, now what we've got is we went in and grabbed some paint can lids, and the reason we did this is we wanted to have something on here to allow us to work from the center of this piece out to the edges. And the other reason we grab paint can lids is everybody's going to have these in the shop. If you're doing a restoration, trust me, you're probably going to have paint can lids laying around. So now what we're going to do is go ahead and get this and lay it over. Now, one of the things they tell you with the stuff is to take a piece of craft paper and do that. And if it comes up clean and you don't have any kind of solvents or adhesives on there, you're good to go. So now I'm going to roll this over, work from the back edge to the dead center. I'll move these back so that it doesn't lay in yet. I'm gonna work out from there. What's going on here is we've probably got some solvent issues. I'm hoping that this will lay back out. If it doesn't, we're kind of screwed and this is going to be a bad problem. But that's something to look out for if you're doing this. Try to mostly keep your adhesive, unlike what we did, we didn't realize this was going to happen, but try to keep your adhesive actually on the stripes, these places here, more so than on the regular part of the field. Now you want to just roll this and push like I'm doing here. Okay, the main part of the panel is flat. I'm hoping that these will start to go back down once that adhesive dries a little bit, and we may be able to get those to go away with a heat gun. We'll work on that here in just a little bit. All right, now, the next thing that we're gonna do is basically we're gonna take our clamps off the top edge of this and go in and do the same gluing procedure that we used on the rest of the panel in order to glue down that top edge and make it lay flat. So basically, that's all we have left to do on this. Gonna move on to a couple of other things right now. Wow, these actually turned out to look pretty darn nice. I'm real happy with what I've got in my layout here, especially in the center part of the panel itself. The problems we were having, I think, over here with the vinyl were actually what I would call chemical heat bubbles. And what was going on is the chemical was causing the vinyl to loosen up. This particular type of vinyl, actually, without any kind of backer on it, is fairly malleable and fairly easy to heat and reset. So kind of what I did off camera was go in and heat it a little bit, but I didn't think I really needed to do that. I think that stuff probably would have gone away with some time, but you can use a light application of heat to work the vinyl. I'm going to show you how to do that here in just a second. So everything looks pretty good. The only thing that doesn't look so hot is this leading edge right here. Now we've got some pull issues on this panel. Now keep in mind, those pull issues were there when we started. So that tells me that this panel has shrunk some over time. So what we're going to need to do here is actually go in and heat this and hopefully pull it into position. I'm going to put some gloves on here to keep from heating up my hands with the heat gun. You're only going to be able to do this with a heat gun. You're not going to do this with a hairdryer to any success. So I'm going to start heating the back edge of this panel. I'm going to pull it over the front. You'll notice that the vinyl is starting to become more malleable and movable. Okay, that's hot enough. I pull that corner until it sets. You can also use a wet cloth to quench the vinyl as well. Now that's in better shape. I'm going to just keep moving up the panel, doing the same thing all the way to the top. If you work in small sections, you'll have a lot better success than if you try to do this all at one time. Sometimes you may need to pull it. There, we flattened that out and got that a little nicer. Now we can also do the same thing down on this edge. Now the only thing is I've got a little extra vinyl here and I may do a little trick in here with a piece of wire to pull that out a little bit more because I think I may have cut this panel a little short. Sometimes, with me especially doing woodwork, these things happen. Okay, now I'm gonna take a gray Scotch-Brite and go in and just use it to rough up and remove some of the old adhesive that Ford put on here. Basically, this is so that when I use the weather strip adhesive on here, we'll get good adhesion to it. If you're a little short on your panel like we are on this one, you can actually take a piece of rod and stick it in the edge of the panel, or you can go in and cut a new panel if you want. But we're a little shy on this one, probably due to my bad woodwork. You can actually do that to fill out the edge of the panel. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put down my weather strip adhesive both on the vinyl here and on the panel. Now they originally put staples in the panel on these cars and we don't have the short staples that they used. So we're just going to have to hope that our weather strip adhesive will bond to this white panel board and our vinyl and make this stuff stick. Okay, let that set up for a couple minutes and then we will go in and actually glue this position here down. Okay, now I'm gonna set a corner here and kind of show you how this works. Looks like our weather strip adhesive is about right. And this vinyl is old enough that it's kind of crunchy and crusty, but if you go in and hit it with a little bit of heat, it takes the crusty out of it. You don't want to leave the heat on there. Like I said, you'll be able to smell when it's ready to go. And you have a little bit of work time with it, not a ton. There, that's how you set a corner. Like I said, I wish I had some staples that I could put into some of these areas like this right here. If I had the staples, I could be sure that was going to stick down, but since I don't have any of those really short ones, I'm not going to be able to do that. All right, that's all we have time for this week. While Vinny is still busy over there on the 65, he's really not busy. While he's busy on the 65, we're going to talk about what we're doing next week. Now, next week is the final setup on this. In other words, we're going to be doing the vinyl dyeing on both this and our 69 Fairlane dash pad to give you some tips on dyeing dash pads that are a little different than the tips we're gonna show you on the door panel itself. So be sure to come back next week and watch us on Autorestomod. Have a great week, folks.